I would like to begin by thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this opportunity to be part of the azah of our 10th Imam. Although I'm not yet fully at the stage of recovery, but thanks Allah that I'm better enough to be able to come and be part of this program. And I would also like to take the opportunity to thank those of you who send messages and then the du'as. I still need your du'as to reach to the full level of shifa, inshallah. But it's interesting that we've gathered for the wafat of Imam Ali Al-Hadi Al-Naqi alayhi salatu wasalam. And he is one of the Imams whom we consider to be the Shafa'a. They are the ones who have been given the right by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to intercede on our behalf. And I basically in my mind decided that I would recite this majlis as a way of linking myself in asking Shafa'a from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through Imam Ali Al-Hadi. Keeping a story in mind, a very interesting one, where there was a person in Iraq by the name of Yusuf bin Yaqub from the area of Mosul during the days of Mutawakkil. And of course, being a Christian minority, they used to interact with the Muslims on different levels, including business levels. And this is a narration by a family friend of Yusuf bin Yaqub, who says one day this Yusuf bin Yaqub came to our home in Baghdad, and he became the guest of my father. They were good friends on family level. And he says, my father asked him, what brings you to Baghdad? And he says, I have been summoned by Mutawakkil to go and see him. And Mutawakkil was a very tyrant ruler. Nobody wanted to go and see him. You know, so if you are summoned by Mutawakkil, then you really are concerned that there is some serious problems. He says, you know, I had no choice but to accept the invitation from Mutawakkil. But what I did was that I, inni ishtaraytu nafsi min Allah bi mi'ati dinar. I insured my life with Allah for 100 dinars. That Allah, I'm going to see a zalim, a tyrant. I don't know what will happen to me, so I would like to insure my life with you with 100 dinar. But who will get the premium? He's a Christian, remember. Where he says, إِنِّي اشْتَرَيْتُ نَفْسِي مِنَ اللَّهِ بِمِئَةِ دِينَارِ وَقَدْ حَمَلْتُهُ لِعَلِي بِن مُحَمَّدْ بِن رِزَى مَعِي. And I have carried that money with me with the intention of giving it to Ali bin Muhammad bin Rizā alayhi salatu wasalam. So he's ensuring his own life, ensuring that with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but he knows where to go and pay the premium. They are the shafa'a of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so this person continues in the narration. He says he left Baghdad to go to Samarra, which was the capital at that time. And he says he came back 3 days later on, happy and safe. That was the main thing. And so my father asked him, you know, what happened? He said, I went to Samarra, went to a person where I was going to stay, and I asked him that, can you take me to the house of Ibn al-Raza? Ibn al-Raza is the title of the 9th and 10th and 11th Imam. Because Imam Raza alayhi salam was very famous during his days, his son, grandson, and great-grandson also were all known by the title of Ibn al-Raza. And the host said to him that, don't you know that Mutawakkil has forbidden Ibn al-Raza to to come out of his house. He was kind of in a house arrest. And nobody is allowed to go and see him. So this Christian, Yusuf bin Ya'qub, says, you know, I was thinking, what do I do? I would like to pay this money before I go and see Mutawakkil. He says, then an idea came to my mind. If your intentions are clear, Allah gives you the way. He says, I thought about it for a while, and then an idea came to me that I'll go out with my slave, get on my donkey, and I'll let the donkey go wherever he wants to go. Allah will take me to where I want to go. And he says, you know, the donkey went from one alley to another until he reached to a door and he stopped. And we tried to, you know, make him move forward and he wouldn't move forward. So then he says, I asked my slave to go and ask around, whose house is this? And the response came, Hadhihi daru ibn al-Ridha. This is the house of Ibn al-Raza. So he said, if, you know, this is the most sufficient proof from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about this. And then they knocked on the door, a servant came in, and as soon as the servant saw me, he says, he asked him, Anta Yusuf bin Ya'qub? Without even, you know, him saying anything. And he says, to me, this was the second indication that I'm in the right place. That I didn't even give my name, and they already know about me. So he, you know, called me in to sit in the front area of the house. And then he says, the servant came in again, and he says, you have 100 dinars with you? Give me that envelope. And he says, well, hadhihi thalitha, this is the third indication. I had not yet even talked to them about why I'm here. And then he came again, the servant, and he said, come inside, you have been called. And so he says, he went to the imam, I talked to him, he says, I told him, you know, I don't need to really discuss anything more. The signs that I have seen are sufficient. But imam asked him, but are you not yet ready? And he hesitated. And then Imam, by himself, he said, I know you will die as a Christian. You will not become a Muslim. But you have a son by this name. He will become a Muslim, not only a Muslim, he will become from the Shias of Ahlul Bayt, alayhim salatu wassalam. Salawat man ikbar. So remember when we talk about, you know, the concept of Imamat, it's not only that they were good people, righteous people, learned people. You know, they are the link between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and us. Allah is the ultimate decision maker, but their shafa'at and intercession helps in getting the decisions done in our favor. Salawat from the Iqbal. The 10th Imam was known by different titles. The two famous were Al-Hadi and Naqi. Naqi means the pure, the immaculate, the clean, from the spiritual and ethical point of view. Al-Hadi means the guide. All the Imams came for guidance. The foundation of the Shia faith is based on this concept that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, planned the guidance even before the human beings came to this dunya. And so Adam came down as Khalifa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though there was no one there other than himself and his wife Hawa. And so guidance was there always. And Allah continued the process in form of the prophets and the Rasul. And then at the end of the Nubuwwat, the process of Imamat started. According to the Shi'i belief, this process of guidance was divine. It is the Prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through the Prophet or the living Imam, would basically appoint the next Imam. And so when we look at this, we see that even the Prophet himself in the famous Hadith Saqalain mentioned that I'm leaving two things behind. As long as you hold fast onto it, The Qur'an and the Ahlul Bayt, لَمْ تَضِلُّ بَعْدِي. You will never go astray after me. So guidance is with the Qur'an and with the Ahlul Bayt. And the status that the Imams have, let me just read some of the, actually it's a longer ziyarat, but two paragraphs from a ziyarat known as Ziyarat Jamiah. This is a ziyarat composed by the 10th Imam. Remember, we are now coming closer to the time of the ghaybat. It is the 9th and then the 12th and the 10th Imam actually who expanded the system of wikalat, where occultation will happen, the community would not be able to access the Imam physically and directly. And so it was important to give them certain, you know, resources in order to understand the position of Allah, Rasul, and the Imams in this faith of Shia Islam. And Ziyarat Jamiah is a very important source for us to understand the position and the role and the status of the A'imma of Ahlul Bayt. Just two paragraphs from that where we say, Salam on A'immatul Huda wa Masahibihud Duja wa Alamut Tuqa wa Zabin Nuha wa Ulul Huja Kahful Wara Warasatul Anbiya wal Masalul A'la wa Da'watul Husna. وحجج الله على أهل الدنيا والآخرة, where we say to them that the leaders of guidance, the lamps of darkness. If there is darkness as far as the path is concerned, Ahlul Bayt, the Imams become the lamp for us. They are the alam al-tuqa. They are the signs of taqwa and piety. Zavin Nuha, they are the possessors of intelligence and they are holders of the wisdom. They are refuge for mankind. They are the heirs of the prophets. Whatever all the prophets, including our prophet had, has been inherited by the Imam one after another. They are al-mathalul a'la, means the ideal role models. We don't need to look here and there. And then they are the good prayer, the prayer of Ibrahim alayhi salam for the imams to come from his descendants. They are the proofs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the people of this dunya and for the akhirah. And then the dua goes on, as-salamu ala mahal ma'rifatillah, the source of knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَسَاكِنِ بَرَكَةِ اللَّهِ, they are the store of Allah's blessings. وَمَعَادَنِ حِكْمَةِ اللَّهِ, they are the mines of Allah's wisdom. وَحَفَظَةُ سِرِّ اللَّهِ, they are the protector of Allah's secrets, the possessors of Allah's book, the heirs of Allah's prophets, and the progeny of the messenger of Allah, Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Don't want to prolong tonight's majlis, inshallah you'll have ample time for your azadari and matam. Let me go to just one example. When we talk about Imam Ali al-Naqi al-Hadi, the guide, even their personal life was a source of guidance for us. An example which I have used before, but I would like to elaborate on that more tonight, is that Imam had a servant in Samarra by the name of Kafur. And one of his duties was, he used to live with the Imam, that during the night, before he goes to sleep, there was a specified area where Imam had asked him, you put the bucket of water for me so that when I get up for Namaz al-Shab and for Fajr, I would have the water. I don't want you... Don't want to wake you up in the middle of the night. Kafur says that Imam again reminded me that night that before, you know, you do the other things, make sure you've done this. And Kafur says, I forgot that day. Went to sleep, forgetting about it, until I heard the voice of the Imam loud. And he realized that he had forgotten to put the water for the wuzu. And so he was afraid, you know, that there will be some scolding today, tonight. So he goes to the Imam, and there Imam asked him, Ya waylak, ama arifta rasmi? Do not you know my method of wuzu? That I, even if it's winter, and it was winter season, even in cold nights when I do wuzu, I do the wuzu with the cold water. But you have warmed it up for me tonight. Means you got up just, you know, a while, not that long, in order to warm up this water, and now you have kept it, so when I wake up now, you know, the water would still be warm. Don't you know that I do wuzu with the cold water? And Kafur says, Wallahi ya Sayyidi ma taraktu satl wal alma. I didn't put this bucket there, and I didn't even warm the water. So it's not me who has done this. And this is where the Imam says, Alhamdulillah. Wallahu la tarakna rukhsatan wa la radadna manhatan. That we will never ever reject the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Kafur didn't do it. So this was a blessing for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That your servant has not doing, I'll do it and I warm the water for you. And although he used to do wuzu with the cold water, that night he realized that this is Allah saying that this is a blessing. Alhamdulillah alladhi ja'alana min ahli ta'atihi. Thanks to Allah that He made us among those who are obedient to Him. وَوَفَّقَنَا لِلْعَوْنَ عَلَىٰ عِبَادَتِهِ. And He has given me the opportunity to help me in worshipping Him. And then he says, my grandfather, the Prophet, used to say, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْبُبُ عَلَىٰ مَنْ لَا يَقْبَلُ رُخْصَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala becomes angry or upset with someone who does not accept the ruqsa and the convenience that Allah has given to us. Sometimes we see that, you know, attitude. We realize, you look at the whole story of shaitan, right at the beginning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the assembly of malaika, where shaitan, being a jinn, still had elevated to a status where he was there. And he was included in the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do sajda to Adam. And what does he say? He said, Allah, I have worshipped you for years and years and years. And I will only do sajda to you and no one else. Maybe a person, you know, a human being will say, oh, he's such a loyal, you know, servant of me. Doesn't want to do sajda to anyone but me. And what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? He was banished. And he became mal'oon. Why? Because the whole idea of worshipping Allah and being obedient to Him is to be obedient the way He wants us to obey Him. Not according to my own standard. I can't get up one day, you know, and feeling well. Now that Allah has given me total shafa today, instead of 2 rakat fajr, I will do it 4 rakat. No, that namaz will be rejected and become batil. I can do my 2 rakat fajr namaz and do maybe 2 extra as a sunnat, shukr for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But I can't change the way Allah wants me to do things. And so when we talk about rukhsat, wherever Allah has given us the rukhsat, you know, we have, and rukhsat means what? He has given us the convenience. Okay, do it this way easily. You know, when we talk about traveling these days, people come and say, you know, well, maybe those laws about traveling, fasting and traveling was for the days of camels, not the, when we have aeroplanes. You know, it's so easy for us. It's not an issue of being easy and hard. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ كَانَ عَلَىٰ سَفَرٍ Surah Baqarah. Whoever is traveling or not feeling well, then they fast the other days. Whether it is the days of the Prophet you know, when they travel by camel or the planes, it doesn't make any difference. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us that convenience. And to reject that convenience is actually to insult Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, doing prayers, qasr. Well, you know, I'm in business class, comfortable, I can do it, 4 rakat. But Allah doesn't want you 4 rakat in traveling. He just wants 2 rakat. Doing 4 rakat becomes like what shaitan had done. That I'll do sijda for you thousands of years, but not to a human being. The issue is who is asking us to do what. You know, similarly I would say, sometimes I hear, oh, I want to pay zakat on this item. Well, our imams have said it's not wajib except in this list that we have. No, I want to do it. You want to give it in charity, you can give it. With the niyat of charity and donation, yes, nobody stops you. You give your whole, you know, 100% of whatever you have. But don't say, I will do it with as a wajib zakat. There are rules and regulations where it applies, where it doesn't apply. Similarly, when it comes to Hajj, Hajj becomes wajib only when you have the capability, physically and financially, to travel. Is it even wajib for you to save so that you become mustati and capable to travel? No. Nobody says that. Only when you have enough to travel, that's where it becomes wajib on you, and then you have to do it. And so we have to realize that, you know, even the wajib a'la a'mal is there, but there are conditions when they become wajib. This issue of, for example, praying Zuhr and Asr. Many people say, Maulana, but you know, this is convenience. Shiyon ki aadat ho gayi hai. They are used to this now. But the Prophet mostly used to separate Zuhr from Asr and Maghrib from Isha. Even in Ashura we hear about it, it's true. But look at the hadith of the Prophet. The same Prophet who, because the Sunnis believe that whenever there is emergency or raining or something like that, you combine the prayers. But the Prophet one day combined it without any reason. There was no excuse to do that. When he was asked, he uses the word كَيْ لَا يَكُونُ حَرَجُ عَلَىٰ أُمَّتِي. The word haraj is there. So that my ummat would not find itself in inconvenience, in difficulty. Rasulullah himself says that I have combined these two prayers today in order to make it easy for the ummah. He has given the ruqsa and the example. So we don't condemn anyone who is separating it, but don't, you know, denounce those who combine the prayers, because that is a ruqsa given to us by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even the issue that we have in the Sharia. If a Sunni does the slaughtering of the animal according to his fiqh, provided it is done in a proper way, the Shia fiqh accepts that zabiha. That is the ruqsa given by the Prophet and the Imams to us. It is part of the Sharia. It's part of the seerah of the Shias from the days of Aima till this time. If you have a personal preference, you know, someone can come and say, you know, I'm not sure about any zabiha, I will only eat the chicken slaughtered by my own hand. It's your choice. And I don't stop anyone from doing that if that's what you want to do. But do not demean others who buy from the Sunni, you know, zabiha, which is done properly. Don't go and say, oh, I wouldn't eat this, oh, this is haram, something like that. Do not insult them in that way. Sharia has allowed that. It is more the attitude that I have the problem than the personal preference that people have. Keep it to yourself. Do not judge others because of that. Because that is something which has been allowed by the Sharia, the ruqsa is there. Even when it comes to the, you know, challenges in life. People become old, people become sick, people have physical challenges. The Sharia doesn't want to put people into haraj and difficulty. The issue of ruqsa is there. Even the method of prayers for those who are seniors, who become old, cannot stand up, cannot sit. You know, there are so simple ways. But sometimes I see, you know, the seniors, when they do the namaz, it becomes even more difficult. Young people would just go there, put the mohr and stand up. And this buzurg bishara is bringing his chair. Then he goes back, brings the table and puts there. The Sharia says an elderly person who cannot do the namaz normally should do whatever they can do normally. Normally, the rest of the namaz, do it with ishara. If you can stand up, you stand up. If you can't do ruku normally, sit down on the chair. Just do ishara. Nobody says you put the mohr on your hand and do it this way. You need somebody else then with every elderly person to help them to do the namaz. Sharia doesn't say that. Sharia says there is ruqsa. There is samha. When you do the sajda, you just do the ishara. You know, but people, mashallah, would like to do it, make it more complicated. You know, we can't really stop them from that. But the point is that if the ruqsa is there, if the convenience is there within the bounds of the Sharia, avail it. Islam doesn't want to make your life even more difficult. Salawat Muhammad Akbar. When it's wajib and haram, things are very clear, no compromise. But when there is flexibility given by the Sharia itself, because of different situations, avail it and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it. You know, let me end with a hadith from Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam. Quoting the Prophet where he says, رُفِعُ عَنْ أُمَّتِي أَرْبَى خِصَالٍ. Four things are basically made easy and their responsibilities have been, you know, lifted. One is when they do something by mistake, not intentionally, khata. Number two, if they do it with nisyan, they forgot it. Number three, وَمَا أُكْرِهُ إِلَيْهِ, where they were compelled by forces, you know, to do it, which is not that common, but it is one of those situations. وَمَا لَمْ يُتِيقُوا, and situations where they are not physically able to do it, for example, elderly person fasting, or a young person has, you know, diabetes and he needs to drink and eat more frequently. They physically cannot do it. Then they are exempted. In some cases, they are compensations for it that they have to do. In many other cases, they are totally, you know, this duty is lifted from them. And then the Prophet relates that to a dua that we have from Surah Baqarah. رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَخِذْنَا إِن نَسِينَا وَاخْتَعْنَا. O our Lord, do not, you know, punish us if we forget something or if we make a mistake. وَلَا تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْنَا إِصْرًا كَمَا حَمَلْتَهُ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِنَا. And O Allah, do not put any difficulty on us the way you had done for the people as a punishment in the past. وَلَا تُحَمِّلْنَا مَا لَا تَاقَةَ لَنَا. And do not impose on us something that we are not capable of doing it. And so Islam is in a way very practical there. And we see this example, a simple example in the personal life of the Imam. These incidents and events in the life of the lives of the Ahlul Bayt are sometimes there, created in a way to educate us about different aspects of Islam and its Sharia. Salawat. Allah. امام علیہ السلام کی زندگی میں بہت ہی مختصراً ارادہ نہیں تھا کہ آدھے گھنٹے زیادہ پڑھیں، لیکن لگتا ہے زیادہ بیماری کے خیال میں بھول گئے ہیں. امام کے دور میں اتنا آسان دور نہیں تھا. جو مثال ہم نے آپ کو دی ہے شروع میں ایک عیسائی کی، کہ ایک عیسائی بھی ڈرتا تھا اگر متوکل اسے بلائے، اور اپنی زندگی کا بیمہ کرتا ہے اللہ کے ساتھ اہل بیت کے ذریعے، اس لیے کہ متوکل ان لوگوں میں سے ہیں جس کا تقریباً جو مثال دی جاتی ہے کہ یہ بنو امیہ میں جس طرح سے یزید تھا اسی طرح سے بنو عباس میں متوکل تھا. اور یہ صحیح وہ معنوں میں دشمن امام حسین بھی تھا خاص طور پہ، اور امام کے زمانے میں اس نے امام کو ہاؤس اریسٹ بھی رکھا ہے اور ایک بار گرفتار بھی کروایا ہے رات میں، آدھی رات میں. لیکن امام کا ایک ٹائٹل ہے النقی. النقی یعنی جو پیور ہو، جو بہت ہی پاک و پاکیزہ شخصیت ہو. یہاں فزیکل پیوریٹی کی بات نہیں ہوئی ہے، کیریکٹر کے پیوریٹی کی بات ہو رہی ہے. لیکن اس میں بھی آپ دیکھیں کہ امام اس ماحول میں رہے، لیکن وہ اس ماحول میں بھی دشمن نے جب بلایا بھی ہے، نشے کی حالت میں تھا، شراب پی رہا تھا، اور وہ جو ہے شراب کو پیش بھی کرتا ہے، امام نے انکار کیا. بلکہ کچھ اشعار پڑھ کے سنائے ہیں جس کی وجہ سے خود متوکل اس وقت اپنے حالت پر رونے لگا، اور امام کو عزت کے ساتھ وہ رہا کر دیتا ہے اور امام اپنے گھر جاتے ہیں واپس. تو یہ نقاوت ہے، یہ پیوریٹی ہے جو ہم دیکھتے ہیں کہ دشمن بھی سب کچھ کرنے کے باوجود ان کے کردار پر، ان کے کیریکٹر کو کبھی بھی نہیں گرا سکے. اور وہ زمانہ بھی آتا ہے کہ اس کے بعد معتز باللہ کے خلافت کا دور آیا، اور اسی کے زمانے میں امام صرف 41 ایئرز تھے، اس سے زیادہ عمر نہیں تھی امام کی. اور اسی سے اندازہ ہوتا ہے کہ امام کا انتقال جو ہے کوئی نیچرل کوزز کی بنیاد پر نہیں ہے، بلکہ یہ زہر کے ذریعے ہے. اس لیے کہ اس زمانے میں جو شہرت ہو گئی تھی امام کی، خود سنیوں کے درمیان ان کے علم و اخلاق کے لحاظ سے، لہٰذا جو حاسدین جو ہیں وہ بہت ہوتے ہیں کان بھرنے والے خلیفہ کے. اور اسی وجہ سے جب امام کو زہر دیا گیا ہے اور امام کی وفات واقع ہوئی ہے سامرہ میں، امام کا پورا خاندان تو نہیں تھا، لیکن جو امیجیٹ فیملی والے تھے وہ ساتھ وہاں موجود تھے. یہ امام کا اپنا گھر تھا جہاں امام کا ابھی مدفن ہے، یہ جو روزہ آپ دیکھتے ہیں یہ امام کا گھر تھا، امام علی نقی علیہ السلام کا. اور اسی میں جب وفات واقع ہوئی ہے، عزت کے ساتھ غسل و کفن کے بعد گھر کے اندر امام حسن عسکری علیہ السلام نے نماز پڑھی ہے، اور پھر یہ جنازہ اٹھا ہے. پورے پبلک میں عزاداری کا انتظام تھا، دکانیں بند کر دی گئی تھیں، اور اس وقت جو ہے خلیفہ کی طرف سے اس کا ایک نمائندہ آیا، اور پبلکلی جو فیونرل کے جو نماز ہوئی ہے اس میں اس نے اس کو لیڈ کیا ہے. بعد میں یہ عزت اور شان کے ساتھ یہ جنازہ اٹھتا ہے اور امام کے گھر میں لایا جاتا ہے اور امام کو دفن کر دیتے ہیں. آج ہم لوگ امام حسن عسکری علیہ السلام کی خدمت میں جمع ہوئے ہیں پرسہ دینے کے لیے، لیکن مولا سے صرف اتنا کہیں گے کہ مولا آپ وطن سے بہت دور تھے یقیناً آپ کے بابا، اور صرف امیجیٹ فیملی وہاں موجود تھی، لیکن وہاں پر آخر وقت بھی آپ موجود تھے بیٹے کی حیثیت سے، اور آپ کی پھوپھی جناب حکیمہ موجود تھی بہن کی حیثیت سے. امام علی نقی علیہ السلام کا آخری وقت اس لحاظ سے پھر بھی خوش نصیب تھے کہ ایک بہن بھی ساتھ ہے اور بیٹا بھی ساتھ ہے. لیکن ہمیں ایک اور بہن اور بیٹا یاد آتا ہے. یہاں امام حسن عسکری علیہ السلام صرف سے اتنا کہیں گے کہ آپ کے بابا کا جنازہ بڑی عزت کے ساتھ اٹھا ہے، جنازہ اٹھا ہے، تشییع جنازہ ہوا ہے، اشتہام تھا، اور شہر کے میدان میں نماز جنازہ ہوئی، اور واپس آ کے احترام کے ساتھ دفن کر دیا گیا. لیکن مجھے وہ بیٹا یاد آتا ہے کہ جس نے اپنے بابا کے شہادت کے منظر کو تو نہیں دیکھا ہے, وہاں تو بہن تھی جس نے اس منظر کو دیکھا تھا, لیکن وہی پھوپھی آتی ہے خیمے میں اور اپنے بھتیجے کے شانے کو ہلاتی ہے اور کہتی ہے بیٹا اپنی آنکھوں کو کھولو اور بیدار ہو, دیکھو کیا ہو رہا ہے. امام زین العابدین کی جب آنکھ کھلتی ہے حکم دیتے ہیں خیمے کے پردے کو کھولا جائے. امام نے دیکھا کس طرح سے زینب نے بیٹے سے یہ کہا ہوگا امام کے کہ اب تمہارے بابا کا سایہ نہیں. بس امام نے جب پردے کے باہر جب نظر جاتی ہے دیکھتے ہیں ایک نیزہ نمودار ہوا, بابا کا سر نوک نیزہ پر دیکھا ہے. فرماتے ہیں السلام علیک یا ابا عبداللہ, السلام علیک یا ابتا لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين سيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون. خدا اندہ اس طلبات قبول فرما, ہمارے گناہ کو بخش دے, ہماری توفیقات میں اضافہ فرما, امام کے ظہر میں تعجل فرما. ربنا تقبل منا انك انت السميع العليم.